All right, now we're going to transition to the lower gastrointestinal tract. So we're going to see that digestion is going to continue here, but more importantly, we're going to see the majority of our absorption of materials occurs within this lower section. See, I got a special guest here today. He's just been fed and he should sleep for a while now, so we'll probably rock through this without a problem. This will be worksheet 10.1. We'll start today looking at the basic function and anatomy of the lower GI organs. All right, as mentioned previously, we said that both digestion and absorption will continue within the lower GI tract organs. And notably, the majority of absorption will occur within this lower section. Also, we'll see that those materials that can't be digested or absorbed, they will be eliminated. The small intestine is divided into three different regions. Those are the duodenum, the jejunum, and the ileum. And remember in the last lecture, we said that the duodenum, it's actually part of the upper GI tract. So the jejunum and the ileum are part of the lower. To help you remember the order, this is stupid, but I've told students this in the past. Just do the D, J, ileum. Okay, that's the hottest new DJ on the block, but it'll help you remember the order. So, duodenum, jejunum, ileum. The small intestine will receive the acidic chyme from the stomach via that pyloric sphincter. And here we're going to add in secretions from accessory organs to the small intestine. So here, for example, they're showing the gallbladder. That's going to add bile to the small intestine to help with the breakdown of fats. And we see that most chemical digestion and absorption happens within the small intestine. We'll see the breakdown of macromolecules is highest here, as well as the absorption of nutrients, water, and electrolytes. And in fact, after the small intestine, we don't see any digestion, and we see absorption of only water and salt, not nutrients. The accessory digestive organs secrete bile and pancreatic juice to aid in the digestion within the small intestine. We'll see that the liver produces bile, and then that is then stored and concentrated within the gallbladder, where it will then be released into the small intestine to help break down lipids. We'll also see the pancreas makes and secretes pancreatic juices. These contain digestive enzymes to aid in digestion. Now, both bile and pancreatic juice contain bicarbonate, and that's to help neutralize that acidic chyme that enters the first part of the small intestine, the duodenum. The large intestine will then receive a semi-fluid mass from the small intestine, and the large intestine is going to convert that to feces, primarily through the absorption of water. We'll also see the absorption of some electrolytes and some vitamins. Specifically, we'll talk about vitamins B and K. So vitamins B and K are made by bacteria within the large intestine. There's this probiotic bacteria, just members of the gut microbiota, and they're able to synthesize vitamin K and most of those water-soluble B vitamins. So finally, we're left with the feces within the large intestine, and that's eliminated through the anus. Now we'll work through the three segments of the small intestine and talk about their relative digestive and absorptive characteristics.
This may surprise you, but this is not actually your stomach. These right here are the intestines. Their job is to absorb nutrients and bring it into the bloodstream. Your stomach is actually behind the liver up here in the upper left of your abdomen. So next time you say my stomach hurts, you really should change that to my intestines hurt.
To give you some idea of the lengths of the sections of the small intestine relative to one another, we have the lengths for us here. So the duodenum, following the stomach, is the shortest by far, and that's on average about 1 foot. The next section, the jejunum, is about 8 feet, and then the longest is the lower portion of the small intestine, the ileum, at 11 feet. The two types of motility we're going to talk about, remember those are the contractions that mix and propel the contents, will be segmentation, which we've touched on previously, and then the migrating motility complex. The first section of the small intestine, the duodenum, we say that it serves as an anatomical blender. And that's because the duodenum is going to receive that acidic chyme from the stomach, and then we're going to mix in those secretions from our accessory digestive organs, like bile from the gallbladder, or those digestive enzymes from the pancreas. Those will all flow into the duodenum and then be thoroughly mixed with that acidic chyme. So the mixing that occurs is going to increase the contact with those ingested molecules, and we're going to see that the majority of chemical digestion actually occurs within the duodenum. The middle section of the small intestine is then the jejunum. And while the majority of digestion occurred within the duodenum, the majority of absorption of nutrients occurs within the jejunum. This is where those nutrients are absorbed from that section of small intestine and moved into the blood or lymph. The last section of the small intestine is the ileum. And the ileum terminates at the ileocecal valve. So ileo, because ileum, and then cecal, because it's going to connect with the cecum of the large intestine. So we'll see that the ileocecal valve is a sphincter that controls the entry of materials from the small intestine into the large intestine. Now, within this last section of the small intestine, we primarily see the absorption of bile salts. And there is some nutrient absorption that continues to happen following the jejunum. Now we'll talk about how we increase surface area within the small intestine. And the small intestine as a whole is very efficient in that it absorbs almost everything that is presented to it. You got to think historically, humans, maybe you wouldn't have, you know, 3 square meals a day. So you'd have to get the most nutrient extraction that you could out of a meal and make it to your next meal. So basically here, the principle is if you eat more, there's going to be more nutrients absorbed. Now, most of that absorption occurs within the duodenum and the jejunum. And we see that the absorptive ability of the small intestine is due to both the large surface area, which we'll cover next, and then transport that occurs via epithelial cells. There are 3 structures that increase the surface area of the small intestine, and we'll walk through those next. They are the circular folds, the villi, and then the microvilli, or the brush border. We see that on average about 9 to 10 liters of food, water, and secretions enter the small intestine daily. And they spend about 12 hours then within the intestine to maximize the digestion and absorption of those materials. And the absorptive properties are the small intestine are due to these 3 things right here, which we'll walk through next. The first of those are these circular folds or ridges within the small intestine. Now, upon those circular folds, we have these little finger-like projections that you can see here called villi. So if we zoom in on one of these villus, it looks like that. And then on the luminal surface or apical surface of the epithelial cells here on this villus, we can see microvilli or what we call a brush border. The first and largest of these 3 structures that increase surface area will be the circular folds. So these are easily visible by the naked eye. We can see them here, these ridges that line the inside of the small intestine. So while they increase the surface area by about 3-fold, they also kind of act as these speed bumps or ridges to slow the ingested contents as they move through the small intestine. Shown here is a single circular fold. Draw another one here just for reference. And these circular folds are made up of the mucosal and submucosal tunics of the GI tract we talked about previously. Now, you can see atop this circular fold, we have these structures called villi. These little finger-like projections, and they actually increase the surface area further tenfold. So here we have an individual villus. Let's go ahead and zoom in on that. And shown here is a single villus. So we've zoomed in on one of those villi. So this is that finger-like projection. Now, the villus has the epithelial layer and then deep to that we have the second sublayer of the mucosal layer, the lamina propria. I'm just going to do LP. So that third sublayer of the mucosal layer, the muscularis mucosae, would be down here. It doesn't enter into that villus. So we can see that the surface of this villus has both epithelial cells, so these are columnar epithelial cells, and then interjected between some of those we have mucus cells that secrete mucus. We can also see that within this villus we have both arterioles and venules. So we see that there's this rich blood capillary network, and most nutrients are absorbed into those blood capillaries from these villi. Before we move on, I want to point out that you can see on these simple columnar epithelial cells that on that apical side there are these microscopic extensions, and these are the microvilli, or brush border, we'll look at next. Shown here we have a single simple columnar epithelial cell, and you can see these hair-like projections atop it. And these are actually microscopic extensions of the plasma membrane, and we call them microvilli, or the brush border. And they're gonna increase the surface area another 20-fold. Question for you to ponder. What then is the overall increase in the surface area of the small intestine due to these three adaptations that increase surface area? And compare that to if the intestine were a straight, smooth tube. Basically, I'm just asking, what is the overall increase in surface area due to these adaptations? Is it A, 20 times, B, 30 times, C, 600 times, or D, 3,000 times? Before I give you the answer, I'm going to use this very cool visual that Clark put together to illustrate the point here. So let's start with if the small intestine was just a smooth, hollow tube. And we'll talk about how much surface that would take up on a regular size tennis court. Okay, so I'll represent that visually here. Maybe you didn't even see that up here. Tiny little sliver of this court here. So that's the area that your small intestine would take up if it were a small hollow tube. Now let's increase that surface area three times by adding the circular folds. And you'll see that corner enlarge. Well, now let's increase it 10 more by adding the villi atop those circular folds. Okay? Now let's increase it 20-fold by adding the microvilli, or brush border, to those villi. That takes up an entire tennis court. Okay? So what we see is that 3 times 10 times 20 equals 600. So we see an increase in surface area 600-fold within the small intestine due to those three structures compared to if it were just a smooth hollow tube. Time to talk about the motility within the small intestine, and specifically segmentation and the migrating motility complex. Motility of the small intestine includes both segmentation and the migrating motility complex. Segmentation is just going to work to mix and propel the chyme, and this is primarily going to occur right after a meal, as that meal is being digested. And then we have the migrating motility complex, or MMC, and that's going to help sweep those small intestines clean after a meal. The main type of motility in the small intestine is segmentation, And segmentation is going to both mix the contents within the lumen, so mix it together, churn it up with those digestive enzymes, acids, and secretions, as well as propel that chyme toward the ileum. And the way this works is there's oscillating contractions of smooth muscle along the length of the small intestine. So think of like pinching off little areas like sausage rings, and then it's going to contract in the center of that area, and it's going to propel the contents both forwards and backwards, mixing it together. Now we'll look at how it eventually moves everything towards the ileum shortly. Let me try to illustrate this point of segmentation. We'll go up here to this top section of small intestine, and we want to pay close attention to the color of the material. The bolus here. So we have yellow, and then next to it in a separate contracted area, let's just say we have, I know it's more maroonish, but we'll say it's brown. Okay. So it's separated here. We got these contractions, separating them into this own separate area. But now let's say we want to mix these contents. Well, what do we need to do? Well, we need a contraction in the center here of these two areas. And when we get contraction of smooth muscle that's going to pinch together the center of these, it's going to propel those contents both forwards and backwards. So you can see now it's mixing the brown and the yellow together. Now to further mix that, we're going to pinch it again in the center of that segment of small intestine. Okay? And what that is going to do, again, is push it both forwards and backwards, mixing it with the material in front and behind it. So now we see it is further mixed together. So that's how segmentation works to mix. The contractions of segmentation, they're going to be initiated again by that basal electrical rhythm, or BER, those rhythmic depolarizations. Okay. So those are product of the pacemaker cells. Again, they're specifically the interstitial cells of Cajal. And if the basal electrical rhythm hits threshold, then we see that there are segmentation contractions. Those are going to begin. Now, the intensity of that segmentation and those contractions can be influenced by things like gastrin or nerve activity. We see that segmentation is pretty vigorous directly after a meal, and we see that the duodenum and the ileum start to segment simultaneously when that meal first enters the small intestine. It's also important to point out that those interstitial cells of Cajal, the pacemaker cells, they depolarize faster in the duodenum than the lower portions of the small intestine. I have another question for you. If segmentation contractions push the chyme in both directions, so both forward and backwards, how does the chyme ultimately progress from the duodenum towards the ileum? Well, you might have taken the hint when I said that pacemaker cells depolarize faster in the duodenum than the lower portions of the small intestine. So we see that chyme is slowly going to progress forward because the frequency of segmentation is going to decline. It's slow along the length of that intestine. The pacemaker cells within the upper portion, the duodenum, they're going to depolarize faster than those further down the gastrointestinal tract. So we'll see that segmentation contractions occur at a rate about 12 depolarizations per minute up near the duodenum, but slower to about 9 per minute in the lower part of the ileum. Now, because segmentation occurs with greater frequency in the upper part than in the lower, we're going to see that more chyme on average is pushed forward than is pushed backwards. The migrating motility complex helps sweep the intestine clean before meals. So during periods of short fasting following absorption of a previous meal, the small intestine will replace segmentation with the migrating motility complex, or MMC. And this is going to act as an intestinal housekeeper. It's characterized by these weak repeating peristaltic waves that actually start at the stomach and move towards the end of the small intestine. So if we look at this figure here, which is showing contractile activity over time. Notice it's only within the jejunum, but this will serve our purposes well. We can see that there is a wave of contractions in the upper section of the jejunum. And this is going to move throughout that section to the lower section. We can actually follow it through time here on the x-axis. You can see here we have the burst of activity, contractile activity, and if we move to a lower section, we can see that's moved to the right a little bit, indicating that some time has passed. So you can see then that these bursts of contractile activity are separated by about 1.5 hours if we follow this down to the bottom. And this pattern of contractions, these sweeping wave contractions, starting at the top of the intestine moving through the lower, that pattern will repeat every 1.5 hours. And the idea is that it's thought to sweep the meal remnants and debris toward the colon, hence the housekeeper. The digestion that occurs in the lumen of the small intestine is accomplished by those pancreatic enzymes and bile. So for example, see that fats will be broken down into monoglycerides and fatty acids. They're completely digested within the small intestine. And we have proteins, which are broken down into peptide fragments, and carbs, which are broken down into disaccharides and monosaccharides. But we see with those latter two, they're not completely digested. So what we're going to take a look at is how we break those two down, peptide fragments and disaccharides, further within the brush border. Okay, so this is slightly out of order, and actually we're going to focus next time on how proteins are broken down to peptide fragments and carbs are broken down into disaccharides and monosaccharides. So right now we're going to focus on completely digesting these within the brush border. This is out of order due to time constraints. I didn't want one 20-minute lecture and 1.5-hour lecture. So this is to evenly divide up the time. So again, just pretend that we've done some preliminary digestion of carbs and proteins in the lumen, and now we're going to bring them to completion within the brush border where digestion continues. Recall that the epithelial cells of the small intestine have those hair-like projections on their apical surface, the microvilli, and these form the brush border. Now, the brush border contains proteins within the membrane that act as enzymes. There are carbohydrate enzymes that break down disaccharides to monosaccharides. They include maltase, sucrase, and lactase. There are also aminopeptidases that help cleave small peptides into the individual amino acids. Let's start with carbohydrates. So let's say we ingest some carbohydrates. We know that salivary amylase will begin to break them down the mouth, and then within the lumen, remember that we'll focus on next time, it'll be further broken down by pancreatic amylases. So that'll leave us with disaccharides, lactose, maltose, and sucrose. So let's look at how those are further broken down in the brush border. The resulting disaccharides from carbohydrate digestion within the intestinal lumen will be further broken down into monosaccharides via disaccharidases. And disaccharidases, ACEs indicating enzymatic activity, are found within the brush border, and they're going to reduce those disaccharides. So we'll see maltose, which is a glucose and a glucose, can be broken down into two individual glucose. Sucrose will be broken down into glucose and fructose. Lactose will be broken down by glucose and galactose. And each of those has their own specific disaccharidase, maltase, sucrose, and lactase. Once we've broken those disaccharides into monosaccharides, how do we get them from the lumen into our blood so that it's useful for us? Well, the first step is we're going to use a sodium potassium ATPase pump. Okay, so you can think back to the start of last semester and remember some of these transporters here. And that's going to maintain a high extracellular concentration of sodium and a low intracellular concentration of sodium. The next step is we're going to use that concentration gradient to our advantage. So this is going to involve the sodium glucose cotransporter, SGLT. SGLT, sodium glucose linked transporter. And remember, that's a secondary active transport mechanism. So we're going to rely on that gradient that we've established with the high extracellular concentration of sodium. And when sodium moves down its gradient into the cell, we can pull a glucose or galactose, those monosaccharides, along with it. Fructose, on the other hand, is going to enter via the GLUT5 transporter. And this is a type of facilitated diffusion. So fructose is just going to move down its concentration gradient with the help of a protein into the cell. That's passive transport. And then once we have both, or I should say all three, of our monosaccharides in the cell, we can move them out of the cell via the GLUT2 transporter, another type of facilitated diffusion. So down their concentration gradients, and then those monosaccharides are going to enter the capillaries within the lamina propria, that vascular layer. Digestion of protein is going to occur within the digestive tract lumen. Remember, that's going to include pepsin and pancreatic proteolytic enzymes, and we'll focus on that next time when we talk about the digestion that occurs within the lumen. So after that digestion, we can be left with some single amino acids, and they can't be broken down anymore. But in some cases, we'll be left with small peptides, which are going to need further digestion. And we'll continue this digestion within the brush border of the intestinal epithelial cells. For the proteins that are not completely broken down to the individual amino acids within the lumen, and they remain as peptide fragments, we'll continue to break them down in the brush border with the enzymes. I got this ACE activity here, the aminopeptidases. And they're going to break down those peptide fragments to the individual amino acids. And the transport of those amino acids into the blood will be both active and passive types of transport. Protein absorption is similar to carbohydrate absorption in that it relies on the sodium potassium ATPase pump. So we'll establish this high sodium concentration outside the cell, and then via secondary active transport, while this sodium moves down its concentration gradient, we can pull an amino acid along with it. Now, we can also move small peptide fragments into the cell as well, and this relies on tertiary active transport. You don't need to know too much about this other than it involves moving sodium in, down its gradient, and hydrogen out, and that's going to power the peptide movement inwards. Once in the cytosol, those peptides are broken down by intracellular peptidases. So those cleave them into their individual amino acids, and then these amino acids will exit the cell via facilitated diffusion. And then, just like with monosaccharides, they can enter the capillaries within the lamina propria. Quick mini case study here, courtesy of Clark. We're going to talk about lactose intolerance. In order to break down lactose, the disaccharide, we need lactase, an enzyme. And it breaks down lactose, which is the sugar in milk, into its monosaccharide components, glucose and galactose. Now, usually we see that lactase is functional only in infant mammals. If we look over here to the right, we have this figure, and it shows the activity of lactase on our y-axis and then time on our x-axis. And we can see then for mammals, we see that lactase activity is highest around birth and then shortly through infanthood. And by the time you're an adult, most of that lactase activity, that enzyme capability, is diminished. While this figure is specific to the pinnipeds, so seals, we also see that there are certain individuals within the human race that cannot tolerate lactose as adults. So that's called lactose intolerance, and it's because you've lost that lactase function. So there's no way to break down and absorb the lactose. So what happens is that lactose accumulates within the gut. So with it just sitting there, we see that your gut osmolarity increases. Remember, osmolarity is the concentration of a certain solute. So that increases, and because of there's more things dissolved there, we know that that's where water wants to go, via osmosis. So we're going to retain water. Now, we also see that there are bacteria in the large intestine that can break down lactose. But the problem is we get CO2 and methane as byproducts. So those that are lactose intolerant experience severe gas. And I know some people that'll just power right through it. You know, they enjoy ice cream too much and they'll put up with a little bit of gas or a lot of gas. The default human condition has historically been lactose intolerance. As mammals, we would lose that lactase function as we grew toward adulthood, and we would be no longer able to break down lactose into those monosaccharide components. Now, approximately 65% of the human population has a reduced ability to digest lactose after infancy, but that means 35% are able to cope with lactose now. So what happened? Well, lactose tolerance evolved related to domestication of mammals that gave us milk, like sheep, goats, and cattle. So areas where we saw domestication of those for agriculture tend to be more lactose tolerant. So we see Australia, parts of India, and Western Europe. All right, we made it through, and check out who is still sleeping. This definitely did not happen with my first child, so. All right, those are your memes for today. Okay.